back to the church fathers, not just Thomas Aquinas in the Middle Ages. Go back there, rediscover the sources. And let's pay attention to the achievements and potential of Lately. In fact, he makes a great case. It's not an easy book to read, because it's not very long. He makes a great case that it was the lay people who preserved the church during the Arian controversy. St. John. So there was a quick prologue from the beginning of the church up to the eve of the Second Vatican Council. My goal, in addition to setting up my means to talk, is to make you realize how holy you are, how blessed you are, and how grateful the church is for your contributions. Having said that, this in a homily here before, but it's my favorite icons, 2015, talking about lay people. This is the new Libyan martyrs, all lay people, all fishermen caught by ISIS, all beheaded on the beach. Simple men. Many of them died. God forbid, don't do this, but there are actually recordings that ISIS put out with their martyrdom. You can actually see this. Who died with the name of Jesus as the big pillar. Remember, the last century was the century of martyrdom of Christians. More Christian martyrs in the 20th century than in any century before. And I always love that case. We actually know if you come up close later, you can see it. Actually, the case of a man named Matthew Arica from Ghana, all the rest of it were not. And he wasn't even a Christian. The story goes that ISIS asked him, "Whose God do you serve?" And after seeing these men decapitated, he said, "Their God is my God." It's not just the early church where lay people show their great faith and devotion, even today, 2015. And what I think is even more remarkable about this, these were not Catholics, these are competent Christians, right? But the Pope Francis and the Pope of the Catholic Church and leader at the time of the Anglican Church all declared them saints. We as baptized people, Christ's faithful, Christi Fidelis Laici, honor this in our century, like we had Felicity and Perpetua in the early church.
Church. If you, how much you make okay. Our call, we are truly, it's a divine calling for the laity. I want us to have an appreciation for that. We have a divine calling. What does that mean? We're called by God to our role as the faithful, to our role in the church. We're going to talk a little bit about what that means. Two points there. We're called to live faithful lives in relationship with Jesus, with our God. So we have to live faithful lives and know who our God is and live in relationship with Him. And we're also called to live the gospel and therefore proclaim the gospel. So we have to, our own call to holiness, which I'll talk about in relation to that, we have to know our faith, grow in our faith, and live it in the world. We're going to talk about that, but I just want to lay that groundwork. So when we talk about what's the role of the laity, there's roles within our church that we can do. But as we look at the Vatican II documents, we're going to understand an even more fundamental role for laity. So I want to go through a couple documents just to lay the groundwork. I'm not going to talk about what that means, but I want to give this background. Because, you know, it's in the title of the talk, so we got to talk about it too. Lumen Gentium, that was a dogmatic constitution on the church, Lumen Gentium, major doctrine of Vatican II. And it's to define and understand church. And their first chapter talks about church. It doesn't talk about the hierarchy, it doesn't talk about the church buildings, it doesn't talk about how we're going to structure the church. The first chapter talks about the mystery of the church. And it is an evolving, continual, Holy Spirit relationship to Jesus and His church, and how we live all that out. And it says that Lumen Gentium itself talks about being the light of Christ, being the light to the nations. Lumen Gentium, being the light of Christ, being the light of the nations. So we have to carry that light of Christ out into the nations. That's what Lumen Gentium is about. Proclaim that gospel to every nation. It also says the church is a sign and sacrament. Universal sacrament. We're going to come back to that. I might just see where it's coming from in these documents. Chapter 2. So we've got the history of the church. Chapter 2 defines the church as, again, we don't start with bishops and cardinals, the people of God. Kind of puts us all in that same plane, but the people of God is what constitutes the church. All of us by our call to holiness, and all of us by our call to live our faith, to proclaim the gospel. We are all understood to be that church. We are called to be living signs of Christ's presence in the world. As we go through this talk, and we really get into this, it's going to get a little unsettling. As I look at these things, I thought, we are really challenged as lay people. This is not a passive thing for us. We really live what Vatican documents call us to. This calls for a lot within us and challenges. So I want to, the third piece I want to pull from Lumen Gentium is chapter 5, our call to holiness. Deacon Bill spoke to that. Our call to holiness, not just in the church, because it's easy to get really holy when we come to church, right? Because it just feels holy when you come into the church doors. We can be very holy. We need to carry the holiness out into the world. That's part of the unique call that we have as lay people. We come here, we grow in holiness, develop our faith, deepen our relationship with the Lord, and then take it out into the world. So that's a lot of what the Vatican documents refer to. So within that document, it says they live in the world, referring to the laity. That is, they are engaged in each and every work and business of the earth, and in the ordinary circumstances of social and family life, which, as it were, constitutes their very existence. It gets wordy. We are living in the world, in our homes, in our workplaces, on the golf course, wherever we intend to be. That's where we need to be church. That's where we need to proclaim the gospel. That's where we need to live out our faithfulness. It goes on to say, they are called by them in faith, hope, and charity, they must manifest Christ to others. That's where that will judge them. That's some serious stuff we're called to. But we're responsible for sanctifying this world. It's not just up to the priests and the clergy. And they're saying we can get to places in the world that the priests and clergy don't always get to. So we're going to see how that plays out here. Again, from the Lumen Gentium, it declares, for instance, that the laity dedicated to Christ, anointed by the Holy Spirit, are marvelously called and wonderfully prepared so that the evermore abundant fruits of the Spirit may be produced in them. Do we have to do this on our own? We've got the Holy Spirit infused in us to be what we need to be in the world, to be that light of Christ in the world, to be that sign of salvation. So I want to just lay out a few more. God even says, actually, the constitution of the church in the modern world, the church in the modern world, so another major document, says, laity are thus not only bound to penetrate the world with a Christian spirit. Can you imagine every single Catholic took it that seriously? To penetrate the created world with our faith. To penetrate the Christian spirit, but also called to be witnesses to Christ in all things in the midst of human society. In all that we do, we are called to be a witness to our faith. Think of your average week. What do you do in an average week in your life? Where are some of your appointments you go to, the workplace you might go to, people you might visit? And how many of those places do we take that opportunity to somehow share something about our faith? Point other people to Christ. Bring them to a knowledge of who God is. So, this is kind of what the challenge is here. For every benefit which the people of God during its earthly pilgrimage can offer to the human family stems from the fact, as a quick Hilda, that the church is a universal sacrament of salvation. Simultaneously manifesting and exercising the mystery of God's love for humankind. That's out of Gaudium et Spes. Lumen Gentium mentions this, Gaudium et Spes mentions this, the universal. When you think of sacraments, how many do you think of? Seven. I can see it on your faces, right? Can you tell I used to teach theology? I'm going to be calling it. Seven sacraments. But they're saying the church itself is a universal sacrament. So while we have sacramental celebrations here in the church, the sacraments themselves are signed and instituted by Christ. So, the church is meant to be a sign of the sacramental world. When I say church, we understand it as the people of God. We are called to be a channel of God's grace in the world around us. Sacraments infuse grace in people's lives. We are called to go out and be that sign of the world and also be a channel of God's grace. That mean for us. Infused by the Holy Spirit, we can touch, bless, and care for people out in the world. People that might never ever step into this church. We're called to be that church in all the places where the priests and deacons and bishops and cardinals can't really get to. Most of them aren't going to be in a beauty salon. Most of them aren't going to be in a soccer field. Most of them aren't going to be in a locker room. Right? Coaching kids, whatever our roles are, to be able to take that moment to recognize when people are hurting, recognize when people are in a different place in life, and somehow reach out to them and be a channel of God's grace. By the words, by our actions, by how we care for people, by how teaching at Ephesians. There's times when the Lord has used me in a conversation where I just stop and sit there and go, "What's really going on here?" They take an extra minute and they open up and pray into the sheets of something and then walk away and go, "I've been praying about this for 3 weeks. You just brought me over there. You just gave me an insight I needed." Or I do a lot of grieving counseling and bereavement counseling. I don't have words. I don't know what I'm supposed to tell that person that's sitting there for these people. Holy Spirit opens up the gates for us. I've been in so many ministry situations, the divorce is separated from people that are, you know, identifying, you know, their own orientation issues that they're dealing with. But each and every time, I don't have all that knowledge. I don't know that person. But if I'm willing to put myself in that, I'm willing to listen, God will do this. The Holy Spirit. There's times I went, "All right, glory to God." I don't know what I was walking into, but so to be conscious of, we don't have to have all the knowledge and sense, but we have to be willing to put ourselves out there and willing to open up the conversation. So that's kind of what we mean by the church and sacrament. That's a deep calling. So, Deacon Bill mentioned Christopher Daly's Legacy. That was an exhortation from Pope John Paul II on the vocation and mission of the lay faithful in the church and the world. You get the pattern here? There's a lot of documents that deal with the lay faithful, that deal with the call of the laity. So this one talks about baptism. Baptism regenerates us in the life of the Son of God, unites us to Christ and to his body, the church, and anoints us in the Holy Spirit, making us spiritual temples, right? We actually, I think the word that I started to identify more with is tabernacle. We're tabernacles. When we receive the Eucharist here, we've just consumed the Eucharist, and we go out into the world. We're carrying Christ physically within us at that point in time, as well as the Spirit of Christ with us as we go out into the world. So when people want to meet Christ, we bring Christ out into the world. That's the idea of what Benediction is trying to impart in us, to see there's a real calling for us. So it's that fusion of the Holy Spirit in our baptism call and for many of us confirmation as well. And this is just a side note, to really bring it home. I've been ministering in the church, as I said, for many years. Started in the Archdiocese of Boston. I've gotten theology degrees, certifications and things. Got a lot of papers that say everything I've learned and all the studies I've done and licensing I've got. There's one document that I framed that I put in every office of every ministry role I go to. Not my diplomas, not my certifications. There's one document that I put in a simple frame. That's the only document that I hang in the walls, in my offices. My baptism certificate. That's why I do ministry. Those other things may have quit me, but my fundamental call of why I do what I do is because of my baptism. And that trusting that the Holy Spirit that's infused in my life then is what will carry me through whatever the Lord calls me into. Find your baptism certificate if you have. Mine is where blood. The ink is coming up. I was like, I don't want to be nice to you, but that's my one. I put it in a simple frame. And when I get little crazy days of ministry, I'm like, that's what I'm called to. The Lord's going to carry me. So don't forget that we are infused with the Holy Spirit. And that's what Pope Francis picks up on, the whole call of holiness. Lumen Gentium chapter 5 talks about it. Pope Francis has the Gaudete et Exultate, rejoice and be glad on our call to holiness. Rejoice and be glad is the term he uses for our call to holiness. We are Are we making room for those encounters with Jesus? And I think the key thing is people don't, we expect once they come in the church doors, then they can encounter Jesus. We have a beautiful calling to be out in the world and let them encounter Jesus through us. We are in Christians. We're having a normal life. How we live a faithful life. How can we conduct ourselves? We can do it outside the church. We can do it in our conversation. And one of the things I want to speak to is the outreach ministries and things that we can be part of. But none of us, when I worked in a parish, we had a lot of homebound parishioners. And they couldn't come to church. And this was before live streaming got very popular. We could just start it at our parish. And I thought, they need to know that they are still valued members of our parish. And they felt like, we're all taking care of them. And we put a brochure together and said, how are ways that they can still be church? And we put a nice brochure together that said, here's ways we're going to have them on the prayer chain. Some of them stay home and get knitted prayer shawls and prayer blankets for a little while. Some of them are out there calling, do you want to call other people? So they told by themselves that they need to know that they can still be church. That they can still share their gifts and abilities. Even though we felt like we were taking things to them and taking communion to them, we needed them to feel like they could give back and still be part of the church. Still part of how we live our faith. So if we're going to be evangelizing, they can do it in small ways, and we can do it in small ways and large ways. What does Pope Francis say is most important about it? Doing it with joy. Doing it with joy. And I know it's been hard with the abuse crisis. You feel like, oh, so you're Catholic? You're like, yeah. Right? It got a little crazy for a while there with the abuse crisis going, yeah. But you're still Catholic? How many of you got that question? Yeah, right? You're still Catholic, right? My husband and I have young adult children. And they got great. They were still choosing to come to church. And they're here and they're going, seriously? With all this? So we can't, it's hard to put ourselves out there, but now more than ever, we still need to be able to do that and be intentional about doing that. So, the Decree of the Apostle Lady says, that we have to be prepared, that we're not expecting people to go out there. And so, very often, churches will have the evangelization committee. And we started one of the church I was working in. And I realized what happens sometimes is people feel like, well, we don't have to do the evangelization because we have a committee to do the evangelization, right? And it was like, we dissolved the board and said, everybody's got to be covered. We realized, as Catholics, so many of us don't know Scripture. So we started Bible studies. We started great sharing groups. We started a drawing group with the lady. We did some things in Mass talking about how we live our faith out in the world. So to prepare people to do that. It's been awkward for some people, but they had to recognize that on the shoulders of everyone, every one of us is called to this was brought home by husband and I. Our children were quite little, and we lived in a neighborhood that had different neighbors, but there was a Jewish couple next to us who practiced a traditional Jewish Orthodox lifestyle. A person who came from one of us also happened to be Jewish. There were some people, Christian, great Catholic faith. But we were in a routine with our kids. We get up every day, go to night for Mass on Sunday, bow them all in the caravan, strap them all in. And they think, well, how come the Mormons don't go to the church? Well, they have a different faith. Well, our kids thought the world was in their faith community. But, well, they have a different faith. Well, what's different? Well, they don't believe in Jesus the way we believe in Jesus. They worship God and they love God. They're faithful, but they don't believe in Jesus the way we do. And so, this is for like a 5-year-old, right? Oh. So, we want to ride our sons on the big wheel. We went up and down the driveway. And we're chatting. They didn't come over very often. We had just had the baby, so they were, you know, so you see the baby. son's going up and down in the big building. And he's kind of just checking in the conversation and come back and like, and then leave. I'm like, that's random. So after about 20 minutes, the neighbors go back to their house. And our son comes up to us. And he goes, we were talking to the Norbert, right? And I said, yeah.
Roles as
pick up some of the roles that are needed. We often have readers, extraordinary ministers of Eucharist, altar servers, things like that. And we're also called to be in the world. What I have found in my years of ministry is there's so many roles that I've been able to do in the church. There's some certainly the one that I have not been able to do in the church. Spend my time on what I can't do. I focus my energy on what God does call me. Doors that the Lord has opened for me. Literally just to hold me. It's a neat opportunity.
Able to be
the needs of all these parishes. But I would say we also have a vocation crisis in our community. And we need to understand our vocations are not just our clergy vocations. Our ladies living out to the fullest their own call. We each have a vocation. Are we living that out? Are we being intentional about that? So that's something we can challenge ourselves with and maybe be more mindful of. And that's the last summer 2020, hoping to get this COVID off, right? The pastoral conversion of the parish community came out about how parishes and things can be structured. A lot of dioceses are moving towards a more miserable families and parishes concept. They call them all different things, but there's about 30 or 40 dioceses and researchers that are moving in that direction. So this document talked a bit about how these things can be structured. The pastoral conversion of the parish community. But the two things that it starts with and ends with is fundamentally we are, again, like communio and missio, community and mission. We are a community of believers that come here and worship, and then we are sent on mission. So, again, I know I'm on the 14th, but moving through all these documents, it's all about what we do here at East to go out to the world. We are sent on mission. Every time we close liturgy, what does Deacon Bill say? Come on. Belton.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Right? And he says it. What? And he says it with joy. Go and announce the gospel. I mean, he's going to bellow it from now on. Gotcha. That is, we are sent on mission. I was ministering at a church in Rochester, and I was looking through the doors. Now you have a vestibule there, and then the second set of doors where the vestibule is a science and service entrance. Like service entrance. They have a school attached, you know, that's where the trucks can drop things off, or they have their service entrance. It took me a minute. Right? We really believe we're sent on a mission. The door is sweet. You're right on the inside. And it says service entrance. That's where we grow. And we have service to the world. The light to the nations. Live the gospel. Bring Christ to others. Be that tabernacle in the world. We are truly sent on a mission at the close of Mass. So I want to just take off. How are we doing? Okay. There's a final exhortation I want to read from the Apostolic Philae, Apostle Philae, which we'll do that today. And then just give you a minute to reflect on to the pastor. So this offers the exhortation, the most holy council then earnestly entreats all the lady in the Lord to answer gladly, nobly, and promptly the most urgent invitation of Christ in this hour, and the impulse of the Holy Spirit. Younger persons should feel that this call is directed to them especially, and they should respond to it eagerly and generously. Through this Holy Synod, the Lord renews his invitation to all the laity to come closer to him every day, recognizing that what is his is their own. Request for the lady, to people who are called to grow in holiness, live that way. So we just, Dick Bill and I were talking about, we both tend to be action people. So I just want to invite you to take just 2 minutes. As we talk about our roles in laity, we talked about the reach or the odd and trial. Take a minute to reflect on what is maybe something you've thought about . Many of you are already very involved, but I would just invite you to think, you know, I'm really feeling like I do need to live my vocation as a lay person in the church and do it all the way. Pray, I would invite you to pray about it this week. And be intentional. And maybe you can do it one ministry for a long time. God's nudging you in another direction. Or another They saw a real disconnect between needs downtown the city and needs in the suburbs, and prayed about it, and it's great to solve it. They got a truck, they bring things from there downtown. All they needed was something with four wheels, and they started to try to make it street. What had happened at the kitchen table, someone noticed, felt it, and so, I know this parish does incredible outreach. All to that, there's just something that you're recognizing in the community that they need, and maybe we also might want to do. And then secondly, so what you can do in the church, what you can make all to do. I remember you think about what's coming up this week. I'll get that mental calendar going, right? What's one thing that I can pray about it? I am very mindful of it. Where might I be able to go train with Dallas at this week? I'm having lunch with a couple of women this week. What would they like if I shared with my baseball this like this week? I'm going to be on the soccer field at lunch with my mom. How can I talk about, gee, we still say grace around the table eventually. I'm going to be working in the bank. How do I somehow share something going on with my parish office right now? Just be mindful. Sometimes we're in the moment and we don't think about it. I think if we can be intentional, how we're supposed to really live that out.
Hearts and our hands. So,